Hello, dear students. I am Dr. Shikha Pandey, Associate Professor from Freshman Engineering Department from the Institute of Aeronautical Engineering. Today, the discussion, the topic of this video lecture is water resource use and its overutilization of surface and groundwater, and then floods and droughts, and its dams and their benefits and the problem related with the dam. This is a topic from Module 2. So we are going to discussion, and the outline of this video lecture is that we will discuss about the water resource, unique features of water resource, water uses and over exploitation, then groundwater, aquifers, effects of groundwater uses, floods, cause of flood, effect of flood, management of flood, then droughts, cause of droughts, everything related to droughts, then dams and their benefits and problem. And at the last, we will discuss about the dispute over water resource use. Because the water resource is a very unique resource, and everybody, all organism on this earth wants water in a plenty of water. So water is very essential, and there are some dispute over water also. So at last we will discuss about the dispute of water. Now let's start this topic with the basic introduction of water, like what is water. And water is a very important natural resource on this earth, and every life depend on water. So water distribution is very different on this hydrosphere, in this atmosphere. So 78% of earth is covered with water in the form of ocean. So ocean is a sour water, so we can't use ocean water. And only 97% is not fit for, so 97% of total water is not fit for human consumption. And about 2% in this water system, 2% is already present as in the glaciers. So that is frozen water. So less than 1% that is available as fresh water and can be used for human consumption and other uses. So very less amount of total water can be used by the human beings. So total earth surface is having 78% of surface on the earth is covered with water in the form of ocean, about which 97% is not fit for human consumption because it is an ocean. So that is sour water, and we can't use this water. Only 2%, and 2% is locked in glaciers that is present in North Cap and South Pole. You will already know. So in this division, only 1%, you can see that only 1% is available as a fresh water that can be used by us as a for our daily use or for our consumption. So it is very clear in this picture, like fresh water is 2.5%, about which 0.9% is saline water, and 96.5% is the total global water. So about which surface water, some 30% is the surface water, and 68% is the glacier water, that is fresh water. This one is total global water. Now the fresh water, and now comes on the surface water. What surface water? Surface water is having ground and ice permafrost. 69% is groundwater and frozen water, like that is present in the form of North Pole or South Pole, that is present in the form of glaciers. As we have already discussed about this distribution of water in our first lecture about environment. In the lecture of hydrosphere, in which I have discussed about all these things. And then 69% is present in the form of glacier, about which 20% is present in the form of lake, and rest is of atmosphere water is 3%. Like this very less river is 0.49%. Swampy and marsh area is 2.6%. That is again more. Soil moisture is 3.8%. Living things is 0.6%. So total the fresh water which is available for human use and for daily life is very less. So we have to use this water in a very sustainable manner, like use this water and don't overutilize and don't use overconsumption of this fresh water, because many area have water problem. Is water scarcity is a very big issue in foreign countries. Like some country don't have water and they are suffering from droughts and lots of problems. They don't have proper water for their agriculture. They don't have water, rainwater for agriculture. So they are suffering from drought. So in India, in our country, we have plenty of water, but we have to use it in a sustainable manner so that we can use for, it will fulfill the use of our present generation and for coming generation also. So why water is a unique resource? So first thing is that water is a very unique resource because it exists in the form of liquid from 0 to 100 degrees Celsius. And it has a very high specific heat due to which it warms up and cools down very slowly without causing any sort of term together, carrier of nutrient, premature jugs of aquatic life. So that aquatic life is survive very, very good condition in the water, in the water area. And it has a very high latent heat of vaporization. And then it takes a huge amount of energy for getting vaporized. That's why it produces a cooling effect as it evaporates. And it is a very good solvent for several nutrients so that it can serve as a very good carrier of nutrient. So all these features makes water a very unique resource. So it exists as a liquid over a wide range of temperature from 0 to 100 degrees Celsius. It can be in the form of liquid and it has a very high specific heat so that it warms up very fast and then it cools down slowly also. So that is a very good thing for this water resource. And it has very high latent heat of vaporization. And it has a huge amount of energy for getting vaporized. And it is a good solvent also for several nutrients. So these are the basic unique features of water resource. It exists in the form of liquid. It has a high specific heat. It has a high heat of vaporization. It is a good solvent for many nutrients. Now come to the water use and its over-exploitation. Why are you talking about over-exploitation? Because many people are using it very, very rigorously, this water resource. So water is a very good unique properties and it is a multifunctional. It will be multiple use by the many, many industry, many people, many things. So that people are using it, making its over-exploitation of this water resource. So first we will discuss about its use. So water has a very unique property and it is of multiple use for all organisms. Water is very much essential for life and mostly life takes place in the water contained in the body. All aquatic life is totally depend upon water bodies, is totally depend upon water. So uptake of nutrients, their distribution in the body, regulation of temperature and removal of waste are all mediated through water. So those water bodies, fish, aquatic life that are surviving inside a water system. So their all life is only depend on water, like uptake of their nutrient is also depending on water. Their distribution in their body, they are taking by the water only. Regulation of temperature, removal of waste, all are mediated through water. And human beings is also depend upon water for their every development activity. Human beings use water for drinking, irrigation, transportation, washing and waste disposal for industry, and it is used by coolant for thermal power plants. So this is very much important use by human beings of water. So and next is the water shape the earth's life, earth's surface and regulate our climate. So everything, either it's our climate, either it's our daily to daily activity, either our water bodies, all are depend on water only. So water has multiple use. So for human beings, it is important for drinking, irrigation, transportation, washing and waste disposal for industries. Industry are disposing their waste into the nearby river by treating. Some hospital is there, like some leather industry is there, like some rice mill is there. So what they are doing, their wastewater that is originating from the industry, first they are treating and they are disposing that waste into the river. So this is a very important use of the water resource by the industry. But they have to treat this wastewater before disposing it into the river or their local water body. And that water is used by thermal power plant as a coolant also. So water is very important for everybody life. So and human beings depends on water for almost every development activity. Because and every human being needs water for their basic life, for eating food, for eating, cooking, washing, anything related to a human being. any activity related to a human body needs depend on water only. So water has very important use for the basic life, for basic life of a human being. And water is very much essential for life, and many life takes place on the water contained in the body. Our human being life, aquatic life, all animal life, all depend on the water for their basic properties, basic function. Now we'll discuss about the groundwater. Groundwater is nothing, only that water that is present underground. So 9.86% of total fresh water is present in the form of groundwater. So 35 to 55, that is more than the surface water supply. And where it is present? It is present inside the sediment, inside the rock sediment that is present beneath the groundwater. So, and rock sediments are very permeable, and it will hold waters. And that sediment of rock is called as aquifers. So the groundwater table rises or fall down depending on the factors such as rainfall, absorption by plant, human activity, and topography. So groundwater, from where it will come? It will come from the rain only. From the rain, water goes inside the earth, and it will present in the groundwater, and it will be holding by the aquifers in the form of groundwater. So groundwater is a soil moisture, infiltration, unsaturated zone, capillary fringe. These are the means that will absorb water in the form of groundwater. So we'll discuss about the aquifers. Like, what is aquifers? Aquifers is of two types. Aquifers is nothing but the bedrocks that is beneath the earth bed ground, or that is the sediments that will hold water, that are called as aquifers. That is nothing but the sediment, that rock bed that will hold water is called as aquifer. So aquifers is of two types. First is unconfined aquifer and confined aquifer. Now we will discuss about the what is confined aquifer and what is non-confined aquifer. So it is very clear from the picture, like confined aquifer is there, unconfined aquifer is there. Unconfined aquifer, which are overlaid by permeable earth material, they are recharged by water seeping down from above in the form of rainfall and snow melt. So you can see that confined aquifer is there, and that is permeable, and it is recharged by the surface water. It in the form of rain or snow melt. If snow is melt from the glacier, that will automatically go into the confined aquifer, and like this. So it will recharge by rainfall also. So that is confined aquifer. Now unconfined aquifer. And confined aquifers are which that are sandwiched between two impermeable layer of rocks or sediments. Like those aquifers which is present in between two impermeable rocks, two impermeable layer of rocks. So, and these are aquifer intersect the land surface, and sometimes recharged area is 100 of kilometer away from the location of the well. So they are called as confined aquifer. Like these aquifers which are present in between two impermeable layer of rocks. So it is very tough to get these waters from these aquifers. So sometimes those hilly area, they are taking very high kilometer for the location of their well. So you can see this in the picture. First one is unconfined aquifer. Second one is a confined aquifer. Confined aquifer is between two rocks. So it is sandwiched between these two type of rocks. They are confined aquifer. Now we'll discuss about all these things in details in this picture. See, this is the recharge area. Recharge area and some discharge area. Recharge area is like water from rainfall, all these things. Water will come, groundwater is getting recharged by the rainfall. So by the rainfall, this is the water table, normal water table. So normal water table, that is confining bed, and confined aquifer is there, and confined aquifer is there. Both confined aquifer is there. And first one is unconfined aquifer, like that is directly attached to the water table. So you will get water very directly, and it will recharge very easily by rainfall only. But see, confined aquifer is there. It is between two layer of rocks. So two layer of rock is there, so water will not go easily in the confined aquifer. So their recharging is very tough and it will take centuries of time to recharge. And confined aquifer that is below, after that, that confined aquifer, it will take millennia to recharge or to take water only from this aquifers. So it is very tough to get water from confined aquifer, but unconfined aquifer will take only days or years to recharge, and you can also take water from this time. Like if you will get pumped, you will get a tube well in this area very easily and you will get water very easily, and it will recharge by rainfall only. But confined aquifer, it will take very tough time. If you will take you will dig up tube well in this area, that will take lots of time to get water from confined aquifer. So that in hilly area, it is very tough to make a tube well or bore well in the confined aquifer. Unconfined aquifer is present on the surface areas, and confined aquifer are present on the rocks type kind of area. So this is all about unconfined aquifer and confined aquifer. What we have understand, unconfined aquifer is very easily to take water from this aquifer and it will recharge very easily. And confined aquifer are those aquifer that is present at the sandwich between two layer of rocks, and it is very tough to get water from the confined aquifer. And confined aquifer are holding very good amount of groundwater. Unconfined aquifer is also having water, but it is just after the water table. And aquifers is nothing but the sediments, the rock that is holding water. So it is already clear about from this slide that is what is confined aquifer and unconfined aquifer and groundwater. Now, effects of groundwater uses. We will discuss about what is the effect of overuse of groundwater uses. So first one is subsidence. What is subsidence? When groundwater withdrawal, we will withdraw groundwater for irrigation, for cooking purpose, for drinking purpose, and many things. So when groundwater withdrawal is more than its recharge rate, the sediment in the aquifers get compacted, and a phenomena is known as ground subsidence. What will happen if the groundwater withdrawal, if we'll withdraw groundwater is more than, then that aquifer will get compacted. Like it, neither it will recharge, neither it will give water. That is the very, very tough condition for the aquifers. Like that aquifer will not get water it will not recharge, or it will not give water. And huge economic loss may occur due to this phenomena, because it results in the sinking of overlying land surface also. And next is lowering of water table. Water table will go down. If we'll use more water, we will take more water withdrawal from the groundwater, there will be a lowering of water table. Then mining of groundwater is due to by the activity of mining activity. And the mining activity takes place in arid and semi-arid region for irrigation crop fields. Semi-arid region or arid region don't have plenty of water, so they are using groundwater for their irrigation purpose. So it is not, it do, so that's why water table is going to be very lower in that area. So it is not advisable to do excessive mining, as it would cause a sharp decline in future agriculture production due to lowering of water table. Because water table will get lower, it will affect to the agriculture, and then if agriculture production is not done properly, drought will come. It has many side effects. So in the mining area, due to mining activities, groundwater is getting lower day by day. So it is very tough to get water table and water from that area. And next is water logging. When excessive irrigation is done, sometimes people are doing more irrigation, and the brackish water, it raises the water table gradually, leading to water logging and salinity problem. Sometimes what happens, due to too much irrigation, brackish water will come. Brackish water is the mixed water. Brackish water means water, sea water plus river water is called as brackish water. So if more and more irrigation you will do, water logging condition will arise in that area, and brackish water is come. Brackish water is nothing but the sea water, and sea water is a saline water. So salinity problem is there due to that excessive irrigation of groundwater. Brackish water will come, and then the water logging problem is there, because they are saline water, they will not pass from that area, and they will make saline to that area. So this is a very bad condition for the overutilization of groundwater. So groundwater should be used in a sustainable manner. So it will be fulfill your present wish also and for your future generation wish also. That is a very three most bad effect of over utilization of groundwater is subsidence, lowering of water travel and water logging. Now come to the next slide. That is we will discuss about the problems related with the water. So first of all, we'll discuss about the flood. Flood is nothing but is an overflow of water whenever the magnitude of water exceeds the carrying capacity of the channel within the banks. What will happen? It is nothing but the overflow of water sometimes when the water table will exceed its carrying capacity, will exceed its bank. Then that what will happen? That water will come in our residential area. It will come to our road. It will come to railway station, airports, everywhere. It will get present that water. And what is the main reason for this flood? Is deforestation, overgrazing, mining, rapid industrialization, global warming. This is due to these factors. Incidence of flood will causes very, very frequently, and it will be termed as a natural disaster. But now it is a man-made disaster. First of all, flood will call as natural disaster. But in these days, because due to deforestation, overgrazing, mining activity, flood is very frequent in India. So now we will call it under anthropogenic disaster also, because it is a man-made disaster. Men are doing too much deforestation. Due to industrialization, they are cutting forests, tree in all area. That will causes the flood to the residential area. Now come to the causes of flood. Causes of flood, what is the natural causes of flood? First, as we already know, heavy rainfall or sudden release of water from dams over causes flood in the low-lying area along river or coastal areas. And prolonged heavy rainfall can also cause the overflowing of lake and river. That will result into the flood. Reduction in carrying capacity of river channel due to accumulation of sediments or obstruction built on the floodways. And next is deforestation, overgrazing, mining increases the runoff from rains causing flood. Removal of dense forest cover over the hilly areas leads to occurrence of flood. So these are the factors. What is the cause of flood? So first of all, heavy rainfall, sudden release of water from dams, because dams will hold water for some time area. But if this water is more amount, then that will suddenly release that water in the low-lying area, and that will cause it to the flood. Prolonged heavy rainfall. Rainfall is the main reason, and that will overflowing of lake and river. Reduction of carrying capacity of river channel. Sometimes some obstruction is there in the river channel. So that will causes the flood. Deforestation, overgrazing. That is already very common reason for a natural disaster of any activity. Either it is a flood, it is a drought, or it is desertification. Whatever we will talk about related to environment, deforestation is already related. Extinction of a species, anything. We are discussing about the environment. Deforestation is a very common problem. And then removal of dense forest cover over the hilly area, that will leads to the occurrence of flood. Sometime in hilly area, they will remove the forest cover from the hills, so that water will come very easily into the atmosphere or low-lying area. So that will causes the flood. Now, effects of flood. What is the main basic effects of flood? First one is the human loss. Because many flood is there, human loss is there, property lost, and it affects the roadways, disruption of airlines, trains, bus services, and spread of waterborne communicable diseases, communication breakdown, electricity supply cutoff. These are the main effects of flood. Flood is very, very much devastating disaster in these days, because it will affect on the human life, properties, and it will obstruct the roadways, disruption air, train, buses, and it will spread many water communicable diseases like diarrhea, malaria due to mosquito, malaria is there, diarrhea, food poisoning, many communicable diseases spread due to this flood. Communication breakdown, if flood is there, they will disturb the optical fiber cables inside the earth surface, and all these things, no communication is there due to this flood and the electricity supply cut off. Many flood is very much dangerous for the human life. You will not get the better connectivity, food, human loss, property loss, and roadways destruction, airways destruction, train destruction, bus service, and it will spread many communicable diseases also. Now we will discuss about the management of flood. How this flood can be managed, because this flood has a very devastating effect on the human activity, human life, and it is very dangerous for the human life. So what is the management, what is the precaution measure we will take to stop this flood? So first of all, we'll discuss about that it can be controlled by dams or river reservoirs. If any river has more water, it will come more water in the season of monsoon. So we can make dam on that river, or we will create river reservoir for this control of the flood. Now next is channel management and embankment to control flood. So if any river is having more water, so what we will do, we will make river channels like this. We will automatically by humans only, we will convert the river channels in different area. So what will happen, suddenly no water will come in the single place. If we will make channels from that river from a different direction by own, then that water, some water will go in this area, some water will go in this area, that area, that area. So it will reduce the effect of flood. So it will come sometimes very less, not much prominent, but sometimes very less amount of water will get, already some water will get diverted in some direction. So it will reduce the effect of flood. So no high amount of water will come in a single area, and maybe that will reduce the effect of flood. And next is encroachment of floodway should be banned. Yeah, that is also very important thing. And next, the hazard, flood hazard may be reduced by forecasting or flood warning. Exactly. If we will discuss about, government will give prior information about the flood and where flood will come, then people from that area will shift to another area. What in the year of 2019, cyclone was there in Odisha, that is named as Feni. So what government has done? Government has done excellent job on that cyclone. They have informed about every people about that Feni, and they have given an app for that Feni cyclone. And many people, they have shifted from that area to different area. That is very dangerous cyclone, but that have no effect on the human beings. And that effect will be too much reduced due to that weather forecasting and flood warning. That is a very great job done by our Indian Meteorological Department. So that forecasting is also very important. And next is flood hazard may be reduced by reduction of rain runoff. This can be achieved only by increasing the infiltration through appropriate afforestation in the catchment area. What will happen? You will do good afforestation on that area where flood is very prone, flood prone area. So if many trees are there, they will sometimes block, or they will infiltration rate will increase, and that will sometimes reduce the effect of flood hazard in the human life or plant life also. Now we will discuss about the drought. Drought is also a very, very prone in India, and that is also related to water. That is also an effect of overutilization of water. Drought is nothing but a scarcity of water. It is nothing but a scarcity of water is called as drought. So what are the main reason for that this drought is? Inadequate rainfall, no good amount of rainfall, late arrival of rains, and excessive withdrawal of groundwater, what we are discussing about the previous slides. And then scarcity of water for the needs of agriculture, livestock, industry, or human population may be termed as drought. Drought is understood from dry weather which persists long enough to produce a serious hydrological imbalance, leading to damage of plant, animal and human life. So what is drought? Drought is a very dry weather. If no moisture is there, not even water, no moisture is there. So that weather is called as dry weather. That persists long enough to produce a serious hydrological imbalance that will leading to the damage of human life, animal life and plant life. Drought is very, very dangerous for the plant, animal and human life. It is a very dry condition that will form in a particular area due to inadequate rainfall, late arrival of rain or excessive use of groundwater. Some dry condition will persist for long enough. So, and it will very damage for the plants, animals and also. We'll discuss about the type of droughts. So first, there are four types of droughts. We can categorize this drought in four area. First one is meteorological drought, hydrological drought, agriculture drought and socio-economic drought. So what is meteorological drought? It is due to the activity of meteorology. Meteorological, it is related to the meteorological activity. It occurs when total amount of rainfall is less than 75% due to the normal rainfall. And this drought will serve if the rainfall is less than 50% of the rainfall, normal rainfall. What will happen if normal rainfall is less than 75%, then meteorological drought is there, and this drought will serve if the rainfall is less than 50% in that particular area. So that is the meteorological drought. This drought can be occurred by the meteorological reason. And next is hydrological drought. What is that? Is related to the hydrology, water. So it occurs when the total amount of rainfall is less than the average rainfall. Total amount of rainfall that is come on the ground is less than the average rainfall. It is generally associated with reduction of statistical average of water reserve available in the source, called such as aquifers, lakes or reservoir. So what will happen if very amount water is present inside the bedrocks, like in aquifers, lake or reservoir? So then this hydrological drought will occur. That is, rainfall is less than the normal rainfall and no plenty amount of water is there inside in the earth surface, inside in aquifers, then that hydrological drought will occur. Next is agriculture drought. Agriculture drought is what? It is due to overall rainfall. It is due to the timing of rainfall. This form of drought reduces groundwater and reservoir level. Agriculture drought affects crop plants. If monsoon will come late, then what will happen? No water is there for irrigation and no water is in ground also. So how can we will do irrigation? So in this area, in this kind of situation, drought is also there. That is called as agriculture drought. That, and it will reduce the crop production and all these things. Now, the socio-economic drought. Socio-economic drought means this occurred due to reduction in the availability of food and social security of people in the affected area. And it will lead to famine. Famine is nothing but a hunger situation. So this is scarcity of food and social security comes under socio-economic drought. So what we have discussed, drought can be categorized into four areas. Meteorological drought is that in any particular zone, if rainfall is less than 75% and normal rainfall, if it will again reduce into less than 50%, then that kind of drought will called as meteorological drought. And hydrological drought is if annual rainfall is less than the average rainfall, then hydrological drought condition will occur. And agriculture drought, that if due to late arrival of monsoon or no plenty of water is there and there is no water in the groundwater, agriculture drought is there. And now socio-economic drought, this is the unavailability of food and social security that will affect to the famine, like hunger kind of condition situated there. Now, the cause of drought. What is the main reason of this drought? First one is the high population that will lead to drought. High population growth will demand more land use and worse the situation. Second one is annual rainfall is below normal and less than evaporation. Then this condition drought will occur. Intensive agriculture and over exploitation of water resource by digging wells or borewell for high productivity has turned drought prone area into the desert. So some those area which is a very drought form, drought pond is now converted into a desert area. That is called as desert area, where annual rainfall is very less, below 50%. No agriculture is possible. No crop production is possible. So this is very, very tough condition for that particular area. And it is all littered with water and deforestation. Again, the deforestation is come. Deforestation leads to desertification and droughts. Deforestation leads to the top of soil exposed to erosion by heavy rain, wind and the sun. Thus, the top layer of soil rich in nutrient get washed away, making the soil unproductive. Eroded soil exhibit a droughty tendency. So, this is the condition for drought. What is the main cause of drought? First one is high population, annual rainfall is below the normal rainfall, intensive agriculture and deforestation. So, these are all related to the condition of drought. Now comes to the effects of drought. So, what drought will cause? Drought causes hunger, malnutrition and scarcity of drinking water. And it degrades the quality of drinking water also. It causes widespread crop failure, leading to acute shortage of food, thereby adversely affecting human and livestock population. Drought indicates the initiation of desertification. Raw material of agro-based industry are critically affected during drought, thereby retarding industrial and commercial growth. So drought will cause very, very bad condition for any country. It will reduce the growth of that country also. So what is drought is actually related to everybody. Like it will cause hunger, malnutrition, poor health growth, scarcity of drinking water, and it degrades the quality of water also. It causes widespread crop failure that due to that hunger will again come. And it is the starting of initiation of desertification. Raw material of agro-based industries are critically affected during drought, thereby retarding industrial and commercial growth also. Now the management of drought. How we can manage this drought? So indigenous knowledge in control of drought and desertification and very useful for dealing with the drought problem. Indigenous knowledge like those knowledge that is already present in our society. Rainwater harvesting. Second one is the rainwater. First is indigenous knowledge to use this water resource and all these agriculture activities. Now rainwater harvesting. And second one is the construction of large capacity reservoir in the drought prone area. Then modern irrigation technique like drip irrigation. Drip irrigation is very important very useful for the drought prone area. Next is afforestation activity, and now mixed cropping and dry farming is suitable method for minimize the risk of drought in the drought prone area. Now comes to the dams. Dams is also constructed to store water for irrigation. So, and hydroelectricity generation and flood control. What is the effect of dams? Why we construct dam? Because due to the irrigation, for the irrigation, hydroelectric power generation and flood control. These are the important effects of dams. So there are some very important dams of India is the Nagarjun Sagar Dam on Krishna River between Guntur and Nalgonda. Sri Selam Dam that is in Krishna River in Kurnool district. Sardar Sarovar Dam on Narmada River of Tapi district in Gujarat. So, what is the benefit of dams? Dams is used to control flood and store flood water. Dam is helpful to control flood and flood water. Dam can also be used for diverting part of all the water to avoid flood. It is useful for diverting the path of a river. Dam are used for agriculture purpose. Dam is very much useful for hydroelectric power generation. It is can be also used for recreational purpose, fishery activity, navigation activity. It generates electricity. It will supply water for irrigation and it provides drinking water also. So dam is very much useful for today's life. It will control flood and it is useful in agriculture purpose. And then hydroelectric power generation, recreational purpose, fishery activity, generate electricity, supply water for irrigation, provide drinking water. Now we will discuss about the problems related with the dam. Because for everything, some problem is also there. So what is that displacement of indigenous tribal communities? If a dam will form in that area, they will displace that already present the tribal community. Loss of non-forest land, loss of forest flora and faunas, landslide, sedimentation of situation occurs, stagnant and water logging condition, breeding of mosquito, spread of vector-borne disease, reservoir-induced seismicity that will cause earthquake, water logging and salinity over for irrigation, reduce water flow and deposition in the river, salt intrusion to river mouth. Since the sediment carrying nutrient get deposited in the reservoir, the fertility of the land along the river gets reduced due to structural defects of fault design of dam may cause a certain dam failure, leading to collapse and destruction of life and property. These are the problems related with the dams. Now we will discuss about the conflict over water. There are three important conflicts in India for over water. First one is the sharing of Kaveri water between the two states, Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. And second one is sharing of Krishna water between Karnataka and Andhra. And sharing of Shirvani water between Tamil Nadu and Kerala. All these are conflict related to water. That is only for the sharing of water between two states. That is very important conflict over water. Now that's all for this discussion. Thank you.
Like, share and subscribe. Hit the bell icon for more updates.